At this time, the men's prayer group is going to be meeting in the kitchen. Men's prayer group, please meet in the kitchen.
Good morning, Life Church. Everybody had a blessed week this week? Everybody still got all their fingers and everything from yesterday? We were sharing horror stories up here about our experiences last night, and I think Ben's got the worst one out of all of us. Apparently it wasn't a very good finale. Some people's got burns and black marks. But let's stand this morning and begin worshiping our Lord and Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
The Lion of Judah, he's roaring with power.
Bible tells us that one day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. Lord Jesus, amen.
Amen.
You know, we can sit up here and talk for days about how good God is, how great God is. I could tell you story after story of everything he's done for me in my life, ways that he saved me from destruction, different things. You know, we serve just such a great, great God. Amen. So let's all together just real loud at the top of our lungs, let's say, God, you're so good. Ready? God, you're so good. One more time. God, you're so good.
Amen.
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we bow in your presence this morning, Lord, Lord, we just want to thank you for everything you've done. Lord, we just thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for what you've done for me. What you've done for me in my life, Father. Lord, we just pray that you be with this service this morning. Father, we pray that you be with the worship this morning, Lord, that your name be praised through song, Father. Lord, be with Brother Isaiah as he brings forth your word this morning, Father. Just give him the words you'd have him to say, hiding behind the cross, Lord. Lord, we just pray as we do every single Sunday, Father, and can't say it enough. If there be one here that doesn't know your Son Jesus as their personal Savior, Lord, we pray that today will be the day of salvation. Forgive me where we fail you. Love you. We praise you. It's all last name I pray. Amen.
You're so good, God.
suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Life Church. If you have your Bibles this morning, take them, open them up. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to continue our series this morning entitled Group Me. Group Me. So if this is your first Sunday, you've only missed one sermon. Last week we looked at Galatia. We're going through the Pauline epistles and we're examining those letters that the Apostle Paul wrote to these churches because they serve as an encouragement, they serve as conviction. Sometimes we can look at them and say, man, I don't want to be like this church, i.e. this morning. We don't want to be like the church at Corinth per se. You pray for me this morning. We've had mic trouble, so I am using this handheld. So those of you that are sitting in the front row, I'm a hand talker, so beware. Kind of like being at one of those Major League Baseball games we used to have, and they had announced the importance of keeping your eye on the ball in the game at all time. That way you don't get hit with a foul. That's kind of where we're at this morning. But we're all going to get through it. Touch your neighbor and tell them, and we're all going to get through it together. I guess anybody can do that, can't they? I'm glad you're here, though. We're going to have fun this morning. Stand with me as you honor the reading of the Word of God. We're going to look at the book of Corinthians this morning. And so a little backstory on Corinth. It's set about 40 miles west of Athens. So if you're looking for a geography lesson, that's about as deep as I'm going to go into it today. It was very important, though. It was a very important, economically, because they were very wealthy. It served as a big-time trade city. It was a direct route between the Ionian and the Aegean Seas, and so it was a very strategic town, and they very much held education and intellect in very high regard, as did most of Greek culture. However, they were also known to be idol worshippers, especially to the god Venus. And some of the things that went on there, you can read about in your own time, but we'll just leave it at that this morning. So that gives you a little backdrop about who these believers were and who these people were that we're getting ready to read about. But let's go ahead and jump right in. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, if you're there, say amen. All right, if you're not, look up at the screen. We're going to look at verse 2. This gives us an introduction. The Bible says, "And to the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you for all your many blessings. Lord, I thank you so much for this church, Lord, for the way that you're blessing it, for the way that you're providing for it. Lord, we ask that you would just bless the reading and the preaching of your word today. Lord, I ask that it would be your voice that's heard, not mine. Lord, that you would help your people do business with you. Lord, your word says to the same church, Lord, let a man examine himself, and I pray that that's what we would do today. Help us to examine ourselves. Lord, I pray that you would just be in this service. Lord, we thank you for your presence that you feel, that we feel in it. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to hearts as only you do. Lord, bless the reading and the preaching of your word this morning, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. You can read about Paul planting this church in Acts chapter 18. There's a parallel that goes along with it, and on that missionary journey you can find Acts chapter 18, what he does. But I'm going to jump right in. That's enough kind of backdrop. There's so much material. This is a long text message that God sends to this church, and probably one of the major reasons that it is so lengthy. It's actually one of those text messages that are so long, it's busted up in two parts. Anybody ever got one of those? Your phone dings, and you look at it, and it says, message one of two, and you're like, oh boy, maybe this should have been a phone call or an email. But anywho, as you begin to look at it, and you begin examining this text, what you find is, look with me at point number one, there were some major problems in this church. Major. And Paul begins telling them about these. And the first problem that you find is that this church was fighting. Look with me at the Word of God. Let's look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at verse 11. It says, "For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household," Chloe was a tattletale, "that there are contentions among you." Now, if you look at the word contentions there, it's a it's a fairly complex word, but you're looking at the transliteration of eris. And it literally means bickering, fighting, strife. And so what the Apostle Paul is saying to this church, what God is saying to this church, is Paul says, like, I've heard that you're doing nothing but bickering, fighting, and causing strife. And he's like, this comes directly out of somebody who's faithful in going to your church. There's a lot of problems. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, as you continue the narrative, you find that they can't get along. And as a matter of fact, there's so many contentions, there's so much strife, there's so much bickering, that this isn't just happening in the town of Corinth. Remember, this is addressed to the church. They're actually filing lawsuits against fellow believers. Apparently, there was more lawsuits than there were prayer services. And the Bible's telling them, like, God's saying, don't do that. Like, the bickering, the infighting, the backstabbing, the gossiping, this strife, it's got to stop. And then number two, in 1 Corinthians 5, in something that reality TV can't even make up, you get, like, just how bad things were. And this is a failure to deal with sin. So not only are they fighting, but they're not also, like, keeping the spiritual side up. Because what you find in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 is basically, Paul says, I have heard that there's a man in the church that maybe even has a position of leadership that is having an affair with his stepmother. That's actually in your Bible, I promise you. 1 Corinthians 5. Go home and read it today. And then what's worse is that not that that's happening, but it's the failure on the church's part in their attitude to deal with it and their attitude that they have toward it. Because it's not just a situation where this is taking place, that's bad enough. But it's the people in the church's attitude toward this in the sense that it's almost laissez-faire, like no big deal. Like, I guess that's just so-and-so doing such-and-such. That's just what he does. And the church had almost become like, hey, we're cool with this. Listen, I said this last week, you will continue to hear this. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Amen, church? And this church is to be like every other church, is to be a hospital for the hurting. We don't condone sin. We love enough to call sin sin, but we also love enough to put our arm around people. But if we get to the point in time where Fred goes out and commits armed robbery, and I, as your pastor, say, boy, Fred, I heard about that heist you pulled. Good job, pal. Heard you got $87,000 from the local bank. We'll be looking for your tithe check, pal. You know. That's to a whole nother thing. It's not that Fred is no longer welcome in our church, but we have to love Fred enough to say, Fred, listen, you must stop robbing banks. That's not okay with us, and it's not okay with God. But this isn't the attitude that this church had. Let me show you biblically. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 2. And you are puffed up and have not rather mourned that he who has done this deed might be taken away from you. He said, the fact that this is happening in your church should literally break your heart. But this is piggybacking off of something that I preached last week. When we as believers, individually now I'm talking, get to the point to where our sin and the sins of others does not bother us, we have problems. When we get to the point as individuals when we can justify our sin, where we can excuse our sin and make excuses for our sin, we have problems. Rather, my sin and your sin should literally be something that, not that I'm prideful about, that literally breaks my heart. It breaks your heart. And that you should love me enough to come and say, listen, this isn't okay, but I love you. And I'm here, piggybacking off of what you talked about last week, I'm here to help you bear that burden. I'm not here to judge you. I'm not here to throw rocks at you. But I love you enough to tell you that what you're doing isn't okay with me, and it isn't okay with the church, and it isn't okay with God, but I'm here, and I love you. But see, as we're going to see in just a moment, if that is done, but it's done in the wrong spirit, then it's bad. If it's not done at all, then it's bad. It has to be done in and through love. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6. Your glorifying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Paul is saying here something that he says to most all these churches, and something that I can preach to you today, and something that is harmonious from Genesis all the way to Revelation, theologically and biblically. It's a theological thread. It runs right through the whole thing. This is the lie that Satan sells. Your sin is just going to affect you, Isaiah. Won't have an effect on anybody else. Just between me and you, Satan says. When in the reality, it's going to affect my family. It's going to affect my church family. My sin, my attitude, it's going to affect everybody around me, including the people that you love the most. As a matter of fact, it will affect them the most. And Paul says, like, you need to understand, church, it's not just your failure to deal with this, it's your attitude toward it. And what you need to understand is that by you ignoring this, it's going to have far-reaching effects. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Then he talks to them about their testimony. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he says part of all this, it kind of comes to a crescendo in chapter 10. He says, your problem is your attitude and the company that you're keeping. He phrases it like this. He says, you're going to dinner with devils. And can I preach to you something that we hear as teenagers and we tell our teenagers, but somehow in adulthood, we think we've arrived and we're kind of past that. The company you keep will have an impact on you. The Bible says it like this in Proverbs chapter 27. It says, the iron sharpens iron. You are, I am, we are foolish if we think that we can go to dinner with devils, hang out with people, be around people constantly that are doing things that I know are ungodly, that are acting upon those things, and then that they're not going to have an effect on me. That is nonsensical. And you all know me. You know my heart. I'm not saying don't have lost friends. Without lost friends, your evangelism will be non-existent. I'm not saying don't go to the lost and dying world. I'm preaching exactly the opposite. What I am preaching to you is exactly what Paul's telling this church here. You better watch who you let into that inner circle. You better watch, because iron does sharpen iron. And you're going to have major issues within your life if you go to dinner with devils and you think you're going to wallow with pigs and then you're not going to smell like one. It's going to rub off. It's going to have an effect. How many times have we looked and it's, well, they just got running with the wrong crowd. Yes. I've seen teenagers do that. I did that as a teenager. But I've also seen many adults do it. And that's good advice for all of us. Don't go to dinner with devils. Paul's saying, guard your testimony. Then he says this at the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Look at verse 31. He says, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. He takes a moment here to remind this church. For 10 chapters, he tells them, you're doing this wrong. You're doing this wrong. But then he tells them in chapter 10, he says, this is your primary responsibility. And this is something, aren't you glad to go to a church where there's not a lot of bickering and fighting, complaining and criticizing? Man, I'm thankful for that. So far, I've had the pleasure of pastoring this church. We're coming up on like 3 years now. Hard to believe. And not one time have we had a bickering business meeting or a big fight or anything like that. That's a blessing. Because I've experienced the opposite, and it's not fun. But I'm also preaching this as kind of a warning. Going back to what we had last week, when we see that the church of Galatia had a failed focus, when the focus isn't on what it should be, it's not long till you have problems. And what Paul's saying here is he's reminding this church, listen, you're doing this wrong, you're doing this wrong. But probably the reason that these things are happening is because you've let go of this truth that I'm about to give you in verse 31. Your primary responsibility as a believer in Christ Jesus, and our primary responsibility corporately as a church, is to make Jesus Christ look great. And so he says, listen, you've lost the primary focus. Your primary focus is that whatever you're doing is that you glorify God. Whether you're eating, whether you're drinking, no matter what you're doing, everything that you do, do to the glory of God. Now, I'll also tell you, for those of you that like to take the Bible out of context, this is a great verse to use should you ever want to try to eat all the pizza at the Pizza Hut buffet. You say, like, I don't know if I can eat all the pizza, but the Bible says I ought to give it my best try. But on a serious note, this is our responsibility as believers in Christ Jesus, is that whatever we're doing, that we do all to the glory of God, that we make Christ look great. Now, what does that look like on a very practical level? It would look like this. This means that you make Christ look great at your workplace. This means that you make Christ look great in your home. This means that you make Christ look great in your marriage. This means that you make Christ look great at your church. What does that look like? Can I ask you this thought-provoking question this morning? If somebody was watching you worship this morning, do they want what you got? If somebody's watching you in your workplace, do they want what you got? If somebody's watching you in your home, do they want what you got? That we live our lives in a way that make Christ look great. Then they were taking the Lord's Supper wrong. Look at 1 Corinthians 11:17. They can't even get that right. Now in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that you come together not for the better, but for the worse. He actually tells this church most times, for most churches, when they actually get together for corporate worship, that's a good thing. He says, not for you guys. He says, when you come together as a group, it's actually bad. It's actually not for the better. It's actually for the worse. And again, that's the reason I'm exceedingly thankful to feel the Holy Spirit in this place and to have such beauty and harmony and unity and love in a place, because I've experienced the opposite end of this spectrum and it's not pleasant. Paul tells them, when you come together, it's not for the better, it's for the worse. Then verse 18, he says, for first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I partly believe it. Look at verse 21. So again, he says you're fighting. For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of the others, and one is hungry, and another is drunk. One guy shows up for a free meal, the other guy shows up loaded. They turn the whole thing into a big frat party. I can't imagine why this is bad. Who would have ever guessed that something would go horribly wrong here? And so that's just the tip of the iceberg. If you go home today and you read the book of 1 Corinthians, I mean, like I said, I'm just hitting the high points. But I think we could all agree, and just going over the material that I've covered this morning, like, yeah, there's some issues. Amen? There's some issues. And so then it gets into this. It's all about exactly what we talked about last week, fixing the focus. Because any times that in life that we as individuals or we corporately as a church take our eyes off the prize of Jesus Christ, we have a failed focus, and our focus gets misplaced, or our focus begins to be on other things, then we're going to experience problems. But if you're a note taker, write this down. Fixing the focus fixes the problem. Now, understand what I said and understand what I didn't say. It doesn't make the problem go away. It just fixes it. Because what happens oftentimes is it's not a hurt problem. What our nation has right now isn't even a hate problem. It's a heart problem. And when my heart is set on Jesus Christ, it will fix the attitudes that I have that are selfish, that are prideful. And all of a sudden, it'll give me a different outlook on life. You see, fixing the focus fixes the problem. And so he says this. Number one, the focus for we as individuals and corporately as a church needs to be on the first, the gospel. Look at what he says in 1 Corinthians 15, 1. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received and wherein you stand. I'm not only thankful, me and Matt and Travis have had this conversation numerous times. I'm not only thankful for a church that doesn't have issues, doesn't have bickering, doesn't have fighting, doesn't have complaining. I'm thankful that you folks don't come to me weekly and go, have you ever considered preaching a sermon out of the book of Jude? I've never gotten that. Brother Isaiah, it's been a while since you've preached out of Deuteronomy. You guys don't tell me what to preach. And I appreciate that. Because here at this church, we're radicals, and you all allow me to do something radical, just like pray and ask God through the Holy Spirit to reveal to me what it is that our church needs and what this community needs, not only the people here, but the people that are listening online, and then we just kind of go with that. And you all allow me week to week to do exactly what Paul commanded Timothy, is to just to preach the word. And I'm able to stand with this microphone and with the other microphone that I use, and I'm able to preach the gospel and preach the word of God unapologetically. And here's the kicker. This is the reason that I know I have a good church and there's good people in it. It's because you don't get mad. You amen and you clap. And all of a sudden, I realized in pastoring this church, I'm not the only radical out there that just loves Jesus and wants to hear the word. And so Paul says, listen, the emphasis has to be on the gospel. And I am grateful for a church that will allow me to preach the gospel and allow Matt to sing the gospel, which is exactly what I told Matt. He said, well, what kind of stuff do you want to sing? I don't care. The only way and reason I'll care is as long as it meets the litmus test biblically of what God deems worship to be. And so if you're looking for a reference verse on that, I'm not preaching on that this morning, but John chapter 4, verse 24 said, God is a spirit, and they that worship him, or the worshipers, must worship him in spirit and in truth. There's your litmus test. So that's why I get so jacked up and excited when Matt's up here singing songs and my theological brain goes right to Bible verses and we're singing like, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, because of all the songs that you could possibly pick out, that's one that I know we'll be singing for eternity. The reason it's called Revelation Song is because that's the worship song that you find being sung in the book of Revelation for all of eternity. And so if you're a person that says, I don't really like that song, you may be disappointed when you get to heaven. But I'm thankful for a church that will allow me to preach the gospel, allow us to sing the gospel, and allow us to take the gospel and support missions so that the gospel can be preached, not just here, but all over the state and in other countries. Amen? That's the goal. But then I would also be failed if I did not mention and I did not point out what he also told this church. Go back and look at it. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. Now, I'm going to preach this again in a future message. But I think, by and large, what I said a moment ago was applicable. Uh-oh. Check, check. Here we go. What I said a moment ago is applicable, but fixing the focus fixes the problem. But we've also got to understand that it's our responsibility in Christ Jesus to stand. And we're going to come to this again when we hit the letter to the Ephesian church, because that's very, very important in that letter. But I think now more than ever in our nation's history and in the history of the church, we're being called upon to stand, and we better stand. Stand in the gospel. Stand on the word. We need to stand. So he reminds them, where do you stand? Stand on the word. You stand in the gospel. And then he talks about preaching the gospel. 1 Corinthians 1:18. He says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. When you preach the gospel, declare the gospel, when you preach the word, when you sing the word, it holds power. And a great deal of it. And I've preached before and not even been preaching on the doctrine of salvation and seen people saved. Just right here in this church, I think our count's up to 3 or 4 people that we've seen saved before I even come up here and take a microphone. They just got saved during worship. How is that possible? Because we're singing the word. And the Bible says that the word of God never returns void, and it's powerful. And to those that are lost, to those that don't understand, to a lost and dying world, they're never going to understand this stuff. And to them, it's absolute, as we would say in the South, it's tomfoolery, it's nonsensical, it's foolishness. But if you've ever seen it, if you've ever experienced it, it's the power of God. How that God can actually save a person, forgive their sins, change them from the inside out. It's powerful. Then he tells them the importance of love. So he gets to all this. He tells them about their failed focus, just like he did the Galatian church. He tells them the importance of the gospel. And then literally he transitions into talking to them about love. And you've probably heard this if you've ever been to a wedding. You've probably seen what I'm about to preach on a coffee cup. But it comes from 1 Corinthians 13. And the entire chapter is about the love of God. Agape love. Anybody ever heard that phrase? Not phileos, not eros, but agape. It's unconditional love. It's the love that God had for us. It's the love of God that says, like, you know, I understand that Isaiah Super is a sinner. And I understand that he's a mess up, and I understand that he does some things that I don't agree with and that I know are evil, but I love him enough to send my son Jesus to die for him anyway. Romans chapter 5 says it like this: but God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Agape love. And he reminds this church, after he tells them, you're suing one another. You're fighting with one another. You're complaining constantly. He tells them the importance of unconditional agape love. Now, if you've been zoned out for just a minute, I'm going to bring you back in for 5 minutes, I promise. Give me 5 minutes. Because herein lies one of the major issues. He begins to outlay for them the importance of love. And then he says things like, love bears all things. Love believes all things. He says, love endures all things. Did you know that love is a choice? You're going to choose whether you get angry or whether you love. And this goes back to the focus. If you want love to be a focus in your life, it'll radically change you from the inside out. It'll change every aspect of your life. Unconditional love will change every aspect, every motive, every thought. It'll take you from a place of pride to an absolute place of humility, which is ironically enough where God wants you anyway. You see, pride looks at all the different things that you would change. Amen, if you're with me. Yeah. Those things that you would change about your coworkers. Especially that coworker that does that thing that gets on your nerves that you just don't like. Pride understands and notices everything that you would change about your church. All those things that you don't like. All those things that if somebody were to come and ask you and you got to call the shots that you would, yeah, I don't like that. Don't like it. Watch this. Pride will do the same thing with your spouse. And you begin to notice all the negative things, and you're focused on those negative things. And I wish he would just know. I wish she would just do. I wish he would understand that. I wish she would do. I wish he wasn't. I wish she wasn't. I wish.
She always. And what Paul tells this church is, listen, if the focus is right, the focus isn't on what I ain't, they ain't, or we ain't. It's on what Jesus is, and God is love. And he says, so when you have love, he reminds this church that the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those who don't believe. But to those of us that believe, it's the very power of God. Because what we understand is this same concept that Paul said we're supposed to have for one another. Love. It's the same love that we're supposed to have for our spouse. It's the same love that we're supposed to have for our coworkers. It's the same love that we're supposed to have for the people we go to church with. And for the lost and dying world, is the same concept of love that it enabled Jesus to be nailed to a cross, to despise the shame, to endure the beating, to take the crown of thorns, and bless God on the third day, rise again. That's the reason I'm going to heaven, is because of love. And the Apostle Paul says, if you'll love, it'll bear all things, it'll believe all things, and it'll hope all things and endure all things. And love, the Bible says, never fails. And because God is love, what I can also preach to you is this, is the same thing that Paul told the church at Corinth. God has never failed me. But again, when the focus gets misplaced, when the focus becomes on something it shouldn't be on, I have less love and I have more complaints. I have more criticism. I have more anger. I have more bitterness. And that's why he concludes 1 Corinthians 13 by saying, yeah, faith, that's important. Hope, that's really important. But love. And then he says, and the greatest of these is love. So much so, that the love of God ought to permeate through us and in us. And again, it ought to radically change who we are, how we operate. It ought to change my attitude, so much so that if you want to know the love of Jesus, he actually said from the cross, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. You serve a God that didn't just say, hey, love your enemies. He showed you how to do it and showed you as an example of love. Then I thought about this. Look at 1 Corinthians 16:14. He concludes it by saying this. He says, let all your things. Now, I'll grant you this. There's some Bible verses. There's some texts. There's some chapters that are really difficult to understand. Can we all agree there? Amen. Then there are some that we wish were deeper and more complex, but they're really not. Let all your things. What does that mean? Everything. I had a professor in school said, let all be all. Y'all. Let all be all. Let all your things be done with love. He said love ought to be the primary motivating factor for everything you do. It ought to be a primating, motivating factor of what you do for your spouse, what you do for your church, the way you carry yourself at work. It's all about love. And here is one of the root problems. Listen, I'm glad that I go to a loving, giving church. I love this church. I was telling somebody this morning, if you were at our meeting Wednesday night, then you know that we're getting ready to, I mean, praise the Lord, we're getting ready to write like a $30,000-plus check to missions, and we're going to feed people. And I mean, that's awesome. That's awesome. Amen. It's awesome. If you're new here, whether you're a founding member, I mean, you know this, we give water every week to homeless people. Not because they're writing articles about that in the newspaper, but because we love. And I'm glad that I go and I get to pastor and I get to preach in a church that is centered around love. But this also, this entire text, this entire letter ought to serve as a warning to us as to what might take place should that become a problem instead of the priority. is that there could very quickly become bickerings and fightings and complaining and criticizing and analyzings and all these different things. And please, again, understand, if you don't think that I'm telling you the truth, I promise, ask my wife, ask my mother, ask Travis and Matt. That's probably as far as you need to go. I'm the world's worst to analyze everything, analyze it again, reanalyze it, and then overanalyze what I've analyzed. She's church mouse quiet, but my wife just said amen. I recognize her voice. But here's the reality. You serve a God this morning that loves you. Therefore, we ought to love. And this is what I need you to understand. He loves you enough to care about that issue that you're struggling with right now. Yeah. He loves you enough to save your soul and forgive your sins right now. And as a matter of fact, that's the gospel message. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. So whether you want to pray with your spouse, you want to pray with your family, you want to pray, you've got things to pray about, you've got burdens, you've got stripes, you've got troubles, trials, or whether you need to be saved, this altar's open. I'll be at the back table. You can come talk to me. Whatever your need is this morning, you do business with God, come. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this day. Lord, I am so thankful for your patience with me. Lord, for the love that you demonstrate toward not only me, but to the entire world. And Lord, we just again, we ask that you would speak right now, directly to hearts, directly into lives. Lord, that you would change what we cannot. Lord, that you would do what we cannot. I pray that right now you would begin to save souls and change lives. Lord, thank you for saving me. Thank you for forgiving me. Lord, now speak, move, bless. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you. Standing at a distance in the shadows of your shame, there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place? All your trials, all your worries, and your burdens. nothing he ain't seen before. All your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he comes. Bring it all to the table.
Amen.